Good morning, church. Turn to your neighbor and say, God is good. And then you must reply, all the time. Praise God for what He is doing in COOS. Amen. We have been receiving so many testimonies. And so this morning, I thought we will share some of these testimonies to you. In fact, just a few days ago, we were visiting some members, and I was actually going to Sheng Siong to shop for some fruits. While I was paying for it, the cashier turned to me and said, are you the pastor in the church? I said, yes. And then I tried to behave myself a little bit more. And then she said, I've been attending your Chinese service, but I can only reach there at 3 p.m. because my work stops at 3. I'm now attending the Chinese church, and I'm also attending your Chinese Alpha on Thursday. And that very Thursday, we had a report of 4 persons decided to give their life to Jesus Christ, and her name was one of it. Come on, let's give glory to God. So yesterday, I went to do some fact check. So I asked her, is that your first time receiving Jesus? She said she has not been going to church for a long time. She was a Christian and she has backslided, or she has not been attending church, but she has been coming to our church. And so I guess that commitment is a rededication. But more than that, we are seeing people coming to Christ in different ways. I mean, you expect Alpha Course, you should have some salvation, right? What about prayer meeting? Just our recent prayer meeting, we have our brother Kai Chong. He actually brought his friend, a non-Christian, to come to our prayer meeting. And in the prayer meeting, we were actually talking about evangelism, having courage to share the gospel to other people. And brother Kai Chong decided to share with his friend. And during the prayer meeting, his friend gave his life to Jesus Christ. Come on. You want to clap loudly and give glory to God. God is doing something wonderful in Church of Our Savior. So turn to your neighbor and say, you're in a great church. In fact, it is so good that even in our staff team, we have so many different testimonies, and we are also encouraging one another. Now, a few weeks ago, you would have remembered our dear Reverend Aaron Ching. His first weekend with us, he has to preach. Why? Because I called him and say, bro, can you help me? And he preached a message on the power of saying. And the reason why I called him was because my dad was not doing well in the hospital, and my brothers were overseas then. In fact, it was so bad that the doctors said that they could not do anything anymore. And so they handed over to the palliative doctor. He was not able to move his bowels. In fact, for 2 weeks, no food, no drink. And so they said, get ready. We may, have to let your father go. And so I was quite sad. And I calculated the time that he can live. And so I decided, I said, maybe the funeral will be on the day I preach the power of saying yes. And so I planned everything. And when I shared this to the staff team, Pastor Wyman immediately asked for the ward details and came down to pray for him. Now, Pastor Wyman is a man full of faith, which we all know. And he said, I'm going to pray for healing. I said, yeah, pray for healing. But in my heart, while I have faith to pray for healing for many people, sometimes for your own family, you kind of don't have enough faith and you need the faith of others. And so he started praying in detail. Because he couldn't speak in Chinese, he prayed in English. I translated in Chinese, and he was talking about an intestine untwist itself, big intestine, small intestine, very specific prayer. And I was translating, thinking to myself, if that really happened, in my mind, I say, that would be a miracle. And so what happened was that after we finished praying, nothing really happened. He still could not eat, could not drink, could not move his bowels. And I decided to bring my family. I decided to call up my relatives to come and visit my dad for the last time. And on one particular Monday, I brought all my children and I was telling them about the situation. They were all very sad when they went to the hospital. And they came to the hospital and I told my dad, we are seeing you for the very last time. And he turned to us and said, I'm still alive, But without me knowing, on Saturday, he passed motion. And so on Monday, you want to clap and give glory to God. But I didn't know that. So on Monday, we were very sad. And he said, I'm going to discharge tomorrow. And I thought he was, a bit dementia, deluded. On Tuesday, I received a call while I was in the clergy meeting, thinking that it's going to be bad news. And the doctor said, your dad is doing quite well. I said, how did that happen? He said, we didn't know. We did the same thing. and now it worked. And I suppose it is not the medicine that worked, it is the prayer that worked. Amen. And so a miracle really happened, because on Tuesday, that was the good news. On Wednesday, his tubes were removed. On Thursday, he started eating. On Saturday, he was discharged. On Sunday, when I was preaching in the Chinese church, he was in church. Come on. God is truly doing something, and we need faith to believe and also faith to act upon what we believe. Because between saying yes and no and seeing the result is the action needed for... Come on, you can do that better. Action needed for? So today, you need to act upon what you believe, and when you say yes, you need to do it. There's an interesting story about this man who prayed every night for a successful and prosperous life. One night, an angel appeared before him and said, "Your prayers have been answered. You will become rich and you will marry a beautiful girl." Years passed and the man found himself old and on his deathbed. He didn't become rich, neither did he become, did he get married. So in his final moments, he asked the angel who had appeared to him in a dream, "Why do you not fulfill your promise to me? I'm neither rich nor have married a beautiful girl." To which the angel replied, "Well, I did my part presenting you with all these opportunities. I have given you business ideas, chance to make connection, ways to improve your life. But you, comfortable in your routine and afraid of taking risks, decided to wait for the perfect moment to act. Days turn into weeks, weeks turn into months, and you keep procrastinating. So you didn't become successful." And then the man turned to the angel and said, "What about the beautiful wife that I should have?" He said, "Remember the girl that you like secretly and you have never had the courage to approach her that was supposed to be your wife." And so the man regretted because he has procrastinated. So today, I want to share this message about today, not tomorrow. Turn to your neighbor and say, "Today, not tomorrow." Whatever you have heard, whatever you have agreed, whatever you have believed, you need to act upon it today, not tomorrow. There's a great Kung Fu master, I don't know whether you know this Kung Fu master, who shared with his disciple this favorite quote of mine. "Yesterday is history, tomorrow is a mystery, but today is a gift." And that's why it's called the present. Oh, y'all don't watch movie, yeah? That's why I think I will always tell our senior pastor, you must release the pastors to watch movies so that we have more illustration in our sermon. But anyway, this quote is widely attributed to someone else, Eleanor Roosevelt. Now, when you cannot let go, everybody say, let go. You cannot let go of your past, you cannot let God handle your future. So we need to let go so that we can let God handle our future. Sometimes we are holding on to the past so much so that we forgot that our present action will determine our future. And so today, we want to turn our attention to a Bible character and the Pharaoh of Egypt. He held on to the people of Israel as slaves and refused to let them go. And it took him 10 plagues to finally let God's people go. The 10 plagues in order are this: water turning into blood, the plague of frogs, lice, flies, death of livestock, boys, hail, locusts, darkness, and the killing of the firstborn. But today we really want to zoom in on the story of the second plague. I wonder if you have read this story in detail, but we're going to read it slowly together. I'm going to read the passage, those that in white words, I'm going to read it. I want you to respond in the yellow words. Can we do that together? Exodus 8, verses 1 and 2. "Then the Lord said to Moses, 'Go in to Pharaoh and say to him, Thus says the Lord, let my people go, that they may serve me. And if you refuse to let them go, behold, I will plague all your frogs.'" Why frogs? Maybe for us, we'll be quite excited if there are a lot of frogs, right? Because you're thinking of your frog porridge, I know. But all the 10 plagues are targeted at the idolatries of the land. Water turning into blood, frogs coming from the Nile, lice, they are all targeted at different gods that the Egyptians worship. And to this god that looked like a frog, they call it the Egyptian god of frogs, Heket, she is actually the fertility goddess. She represents for the Egyptian life, abundance, fertility, and the germination of grain, the abundance of grain. So they pray to this goddess. And they are actually quite familiar. When flooding comes, there will be a lot of frogs coming out. But here, God is going to plague the land with a different amount of frogs. And in verse 3, it says this, "The Nile shall..." "And into the houses of your servants and your people, and the frogs shall come up on you and on your people and on all your servants." Verse 5. "And the Lord said to Moses, said to Aaron, over the rivers, over the canals, and over the pools, and make frogs come up on the land of Egypt. So Aaron stretched out his hand over the waters of Egypt." Now this is a great amount of frogs coming out from the river, from everywhere. And there are frogs in the bedroom, frogs in the kitchen. When you open up your oven, there are frogs there jumping out. And when there are a lot of frogs, it's quite noisy because they are quite irritating, right? And do you know frogs can speak Hokkien? Because on a cold day, they will say, "Kwah, kwah, kwah." And you would think that the Egyptians were irritated, right? You will be kind of thinking, well, have enough of frogs. And you know what verse 7 says? "But..." Now we pause for a moment. It seems as though they don't have enough frogs, so the magicians practice their magic and make more frogs come out. I think Pharaoh must be quite frustrated by now. And so in verse 8, he said this, "Then Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron and said, to take away the frogs from me and from my people, and I will let the people go to sacrifice to the Lord." And look at verse 9. "Moses said to Pharaoh, be pleased to command me and for your people, that the frogs be cut off from you and your houses and be left only in the Nile." In other words, Moses is saying, "Sure, Pharaoh, I'm here. When do you want me to do this? When do you want me to come and pray that the frogs will disappear?" And the answer should be today, right? But do you know what the Bible say? "And Pharaoh said..." Tomorrow. This is like a comic relief Bible passage, right? But it is also speaking to our hearts, because how many of us have said tomorrow? When are you going to start your diet? When are you going to clear your table? When are you going to see the doctor? Yesterday when I was preaching this message, my hair was quite long. My wife asked me, "When are you going to cut your hair?" I said, "Maybe after, you know, the service, I will cut my hair tomorrow." But then she turned to me and said, "No, today." And that's why my hair is short. You see, all of us always use this magic word called tomorrow, but tomorrow never come. Because tomorrow is a mystical land where 99% of all human productivity, motivation, and achievement is stored. And that's talking to all the procrastinators like me. And I found this clip that was quite interesting. It says, the stages of procrastination. First of all, you have false security. You tell yourself, "Okay, I still have time." And then you have laziness. When you want to do it early, you say, never mind, I got other things to do." You give yourself excuses. And then when the deadline is just before you, you say, "I still have time." And then you think, "Tonight I don't sleep, never mind, can do it one." And so by the time you finish your project, you end up in the crisis and you say this, "I will never procrastinate again." And then stage 6, you repeat again. Yeah, stop poking one another and say, "He's talking about you." Because all of us at some stage, we procrastinate. Now, I wonder if Moses would come before Pharaoh when Pharaoh said tomorrow, and Moses said this, "Mr. Pharaoh, why don't you do it today?" That seems like my wife's voice. "Why don't you do it today?" And it seems as though Moses is asking, "Why do you want to live with the frogs, the great amount of frogs, one more night?" In fact, there was a pastor who actually preached on this passage, and their title is One More Night with the Frogs. Do you want to stay one more night with all these dirty, irritating frogs? I think Pharaoh had in mind that he was in control. Or he probably think that his goddess was in control until he realized that only Yahweh is in control. You know, when God is in control, He wants us to deal with things today. And if we don't deal with it, sometimes it can cost us. And so today we need to recognize that when inaction happens, it will destroy us. What are some of the things that we need to deal with today? We need to deal with sin today. Maybe some of the frogs that you need to deal with are your sin. Today, Pharaoh's frogs may be the sin that you need to deal. Deal with it today, not tomorrow. Galatians 5, Paul told the church, it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. Let us not be bound out in a yoke of slavery again. You know, I read a story about this veteran, very fit veteran, who was diagnosed with this flesh-eating disease. When she went to the clinic, the doctor gave her some medication and said that she sprained her ankle, sprained her leg, and then sent her home. Not realizing that the virus, the bacteria, was eating up her leg. And 4 days later, she collapsed and fainted in the living room. And thank God, her brother came to her house, saw what happened, brought her to the hospital. And in the hospital, they have to amputate her leg. And the doctor said this, if you have come tomorrow, you will have died. Thank God you come today. At least you lose your leg, but you keep your life. Sin is like this. It is creeping up in you. It is eating up your life. Galatians 5 verses 19 to 21 says this. Now the works of the flesh are evident. Sexual immorality, impurity, sensuality, idolatry, sorcery, enmity, strife, jealousy, fits of anger, rivalries, dissensions, division, envy, drunkenness, orgies, and things like this. Paul says, I warn you as I warned you before that those who do such things will not inherit the kingdom of God. We like to measure sin, whether it's big sin or small sin. Looking at the list, there are things that probably would have done, like envy, anger, things that is buried deep down in our hearts. We need to deal with it today. Why don't people deal with sin immediately? Because sin has short-term pleasure but long-term consequences. Because as we begin to feed our desire, we long to continue to go back there. Or sometimes we got used to it. Maybe the Egyptians got used to the frogs. One more night is okay. They got used to it. Or sometimes they feel powerless to overcome sin. When you feel powerless to overcome sin, you must recognize that the gospel of Jesus Christ is here to set you free. It is good news for us to recognize that with God's strength, we can actually overcome. And so therefore, we must understand that God is giving us this strength to act upon it. Because God always gives us strength to act upon what we believe to be true. And so we must have faith. We must recognize that whatever you're struggling, if you struggle for too long, it doesn't make it less sinful. It doesn't make it more normal. It only means that we need to depend on God more and more. And so sometimes we realize that even when we are living our Christian life, we can be thinking about things that are ungodly. Sometimes you can leave Egypt and yet still long for Egypt in your heart, just like the Israelites who has left Egypt, crossed the Red Sea, and while they are in the wilderness, they long to go back to Egypt again. Because in Numbers 14:4, they said this. And they said to one another, let us choose a leader and go back to Egypt. When I was a youth pastor, I've met with many youths and tried to help them to fight their addictions. Now, I remember an incident when a youth lady came to me. And she said this, Pastor, I want to love God, but I also love sin. I didn't ask her to elaborate her sin, but I told her that you cannot do that. Because if you truly love God, you will hate sin. If you want to love God, you have to make a choice today to step away from whatever that you are doing and to say no to sin and yes to God. And when you begin to do that, you will have freedom that you probably never experienced before. But to my disappointment, she didn't heed the advice and she left the church. A few years later, when I scroll through my Facebook, I look at the things that she's involved in, I was not happy. Clearly, she was more interested to fulfill her lustful desires. But today, I want you to know, the frogs will not help you. But getting rid of frogs, we need to confess our sin, come before God as clean as we can be. And 1 John chapter 1, verses 8 to 10 says this, "If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us." Verse 9 together, "If we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say we have no sin, we make Him a liar and His word is not in us." So the good news is this, that if we confess, God is willing to forgive us. If we say, "Lord, we have sinned against You," God will forgive us and give us strength for tomorrow. So deal with sin. One more time. Deal with sin. Number two, deal with laziness today. You know, when I was preparing my sermon, I actually have 3 points, but today it becomes 4 points. Why? Because my wife got involved in it. And she told me, if you want to talk about procrastination, you should have a point that deal with laziness, like clear your table today, clear your mess today. And I was trying to argue with her to say that it doesn't really fit into the Exodus passage that I was preaching. And then when I was thinking about this, then I realized that, you know what happened to the frogs? Do you know what happened to the frogs? You do not know, right? So let's read Exodus chapter 8, verses 12 and 13. "So Moses and Aaron went out from Pharaoh, and Pharaoh cried out to the Lord about the frogs, and He has agreed with Pharaoh. And the Lord did according to the word of Moses." Together, the... So when I read that, I turned to my wife and said, "Yeah, I think I should put down 1 point. Clear the dead frogs." There are dead frogs everywhere. And so when Moses and Aaron, they prayed, you know what happened? The frogs did not just disappear. There was a huge mess and the whole place stank. Meaning to say that when God is doing something in your life, dealing with sin, after that, you need to build good habits. You need to have good discipline. You need to have God swear to come into your life so that you can become a better person. While you are doing the cleaning, you need to clear the mess today. You need to deal with the laziness today. Have you ever seen house like this? Have you ever cleared houses that's not been cleared for a long time? You'll be shocked to find what is hidden inside. Sometimes half-eaten fruits and banana skins. For those who are involved in community services, we have gone to houses of people that have not cleaned their house for a long time and we went in to clean for them. And there are a huge amount of rubbish there. The rubbish can be a few meters high. I remember when I was in the National Service and I was always volunteering. In the National Service, they used to say this, if you volunteer now, then maybe you won't get volunteered for difficult things. I was too naive. So every time they ask for volunteer, I volunteer. And normally they ask for volunteer, they won't tell you the task. So there was an incident when they say, "We need 10 volunteers. So I raised my hands and my friends saw me. Then they raised their hands together. We stepped out and they said, "You have to clean the rubbish chute and you have to clean the dumping ground that has not been cleaned for a long time." And the rubbish was like a few meters high. But when we were cleaning, we were quite happy because on the top layer, the surface layer, was new stuff. People were throwing out things like maybe they were passing out, you know, they were getting out of this place. They were throwing about away all their new stuff. I pick up hangers. So we are like scavengers. We are like Kalanguling men picking up everybody's rubbish and keeping them. "Oh, this one can use. Oh, this one can use." You know, there are new t-shirts that have been thrown away. So we say, "Oh, this one can use." But while we are clearing the top layer and it comes to the deeper layer, the smelly layer, the food that have been kept there for weeks, while we dig it out, there are maggots everywhere. And that's when we are very generous. I say, "I think now it's your turn to clear." You know, it's ugly inside and dirty and you need to clear that mess. Don't be lazy about it. And sometimes we need to clear the mess and instill good discipline. I know Senior Pastor has been encouraging us to read the Bible. By now, he said that you should be in the Psalms. You should be in the reading Proverbs, but some of you may be still starting Genesis. It's okay. At least you start. Don't wait until... Wow. You're a bit slow today. Do it. Don't wait. Today, not... Exactly. So do it today, because Proverbs 24, verses 30 to 31 says this: I passed by the field of a sluggard, by the vineyard of a man lacking sense, and behold, it was all overgrown with thorns. The ground was covered with nettles, and its stone wall was broken down. Verse 32, then I saw and considered it. I looked and received instruction. So he was reflecting. And together we say, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest. And poverty will come upon you like a robber, and one like an armed man. The Word of God says clearly to those who maybe feel a bit lazy today, start clearing your mess today. And number three, deal with broken relationships today. So deal with sin today. Deal with laziness today. Deal with broken relationships today. Many people procrastinate on making peace with one another. They procrastinate because their hearts have become hardened. They procrastinate because they no longer want to heal the relationship. In the case of Pharaoh, Pharaoh's heart was hardened. You know, when your hearts are too hardened, no amount of sermons will be able to help you. You need God's help to soften your heart again. Now, the hardening of God's heart, Pharaoh's heart, many people used to debate about it. Why did God harden Pharaoh's heart? But if you look at the text and you look at the 10 plagues, it is really Pharaoh hardening his own heart first. Every time God showed Pharaoh mercy and removed a plague from Egypt, Pharaoh responded in stubborn disobedience. As such, God's mercy was the occasion for the hardening of Pharaoh's heart. You see, Exodus 7:22, Pharaoh's heart became hard. That was after the plague was lifted up. And so second plague came. And then when the plague was lifted up again, Pharaoh hardened his own heart in Exodus 8:15. Exodus 8:19, Pharaoh's heart was hard. Exodus 8:32, Pharaoh hardened his own heart. Exodus 9:7, Pharaoh's heart was hard. Exodus 9:12, the Lord hardened Pharaoh's heart. Exodus 9:34, Pharaoh hardened his own heart. And then on, God hardened Pharaoh's heart. It's repeated in Romans. And the reason for that is because God gave him over to his own lustful desire. He himself hardened his heart. And so today, don't harden your hearts towards God and your friends, your family members, your loved ones, your colleagues. Do not harden your hearts towards people. Because Ezekiel chapter 36, verse 26, Ezekiel prophesied a time. A time will come when God will give us a new heart, and the time has come in the New Testament, one that will be filled with the Spirit of God, one that will not be hardened. And in this verse says, I will give you a new heart, a new spirit I will put within you, and I will remove the heart of stone from your flesh and give you a heart of flesh. And today is the day. Today, as you worship in church, you must recognize we are walking in the New Testament promise that the Holy Spirit has come, that if you confess that you are Christian, the Spirit of God has given you a new heart within you. And so you must remind yourself there's no love without forgiveness, and there's no forgiveness without love. Learn to love no matter what. Many of you have heard my testimony about how at the age of 17 years old, I took a knife and almost stabbed my own grandmother. I grew up in an environment that was broken, a family that was broken. There were fights everywhere, and sometimes police will come. And in my growing up years as a teenager, I hated my grandmother. I felt that it was due to my grandmother that we got all this disunity and fights. My grandmother would pray to her gods in the past and curse us. And when my father met an accident, got a stroke, she was quite happy about it. And she continued to say that this is a curse because we did not do what was right. And because of that, we would have all this fight. And I grew up disliking my grandmother, hating my grandmother. After which, when I truly understand the Word of God, I became a Christian, I still could not find myself enough courage, enough strength to forgive her. Until one day, when a friend of mine came to my house, he's a Christian, And then he noticed that I did not greet my grandmother. He asked me why. I said, I don't like my grandmother. I hated my grandmother. And then he whipped out Matthew 6, 14 and 15. And he said, if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father forgive your trespasses. He said, Chris, you are a Christian. And you must recognize that if you receive God's forgiveness, you must release God's forgiveness. And so with that thought, he left. And I still couldn't figure out how to do it. I know I have to forgive. My friend did not leave me with a set of instructions to say, step one, you must go in and say this. Step two, you must do this. So in my own understanding, I decided I will go into my grandmother's room. At a point of time, she was lying there, stricken by sickness, couldn't say much. I went in and I looked at her and I actually wanted to do this. I wanted to go in and say, Ma, Ama, I forgive you for all the wrong things you have done to me. And I walk out. But I didn't do that. When I went in, there was something that touched me. I felt it was the presence of the Lord. When I saw her weak, couldn't say much, I knelt down before her and I said, Ama, can you forgive me? Instead of releasing forgiveness, I started asking for forgiveness. And when I asked her for her forgiveness, there was a great release of forgiveness in my heart. All the bitterness suddenly just disappeared. The whole room was changed. It almost feels like someone has switch on the light in the room. And that very day, I reconciled with my grandmother. You know, if I have not done that day, I would not have breakthrough until now. Praise God, because I act upon what was given to me that day. And therefore, release and forgiveness and reconciliation came through. Friends, today, maybe some of you are struggling with some broken relationship. Maybe you are the victim. Maybe you're the one being belittled. Maybe you're the one being scolded, being labored. But trust me, there's no point holding on to unforgiveness in your heart, because that will bind you forever. You become a bondage in your life that cannot be taken away. But unless and until you come before the Lord and say, God, give me strength. And God will surely give you strength to say yes to forgiveness. Release forgiveness and you will start to see power and change and grace coming into your family. Amen. Trust in the word of the Lord and start to act upon this. So deal with broken relationship today. Maybe some of you need to visit your parents. Maybe some of you need to go to the hospital to pray for someone. Maybe you need to say sorry. Maybe you need to love that person who actually did a lot of harm to you, but right now is not doing very well. I know that you're struggling. But trust me, if God has given you the strength to do so, there will be reconciliation and forgiveness and change. And lastly, let us also sow into the kingdom today. Can you turn to your neighbor and say this? Sow in the kingdom today. But you know what? You guys are doing very well because of all the testimonies we are receiving. I believe that you have been sowing, you have been doing unreasonable hospitality. This year, we started with that, sowing kindness. From senior pastors preaching, all of us have been activated to, you know, buy drinks for one another. In fact, recently, we are doing kindness so much that we start to say, I think it has become competitive hospitality. Seeing who can touch more people. No matter what, let our motivation be pure. Let us continue to do kindness. Because the Bible says, he who observes the wind will not sow. He who regards the clouds will not reap. I know it's important for those who are doing agriculture to observe the weather, but to wait for the perfect weather is something that will rob productivity from the farmer, because there's never a perfect weather. You just keep sowing and keep sowing, and soon you'll start to see the harvest. And I want to tell you that the harvest is now. In the 40 days of prayer, if you're watching the video, every pastor is coming on the video telling you, now is the time. Today is the day of salvation. Now is the time to sow and to reap and to see people coming into the kingdom of God. Remember, whatever little you're offering to God, God can change and multiply that. And I thought it's good for me to remind you of this photo, because I showed you this photo before. Remember this photo? This is a photo about a papaya tree that grew out of a toilet. Someone has probably swallowed some seeds and had a bad diarrhea. And when you look at this tree, you must marvel at what has happened because the size of the fruits are huge. I'm not sure whether I will eat them, but there are fruits there. Therefore, the problem is not about the environment. Stop complaining about how bad your environment is, because in the worst situation that you can be placed in, God is saying to you, I have elected you and chosen you for such a time as this, because I'm going to fill my spirit upon you so that in the bad environment, the dark situation, you are the light. There's no point putting you in a place that's full of light, isn't it? When everybody is nice and you can seep in and seep out, nobody notice you, and the gospel has never been preached. But if you are placed in a dark place, remember, don't become dark also. Remember, you are the light. You don't switch off the light. You are the light. So don't stop sowing. Don't stop sowing the gospel into people's lives. Don't give up. Just keep doing it. And all the testimonies we are receiving, we want more. Because testimonies glorify God's name. It makes sense of the preaching we are doing here. It makes sense of the explanation and exegesis of Scripture, because we are seeing it happening before us. And so I'm going to read to you some of the testimonies that we have received. At a recent funeral, there was a funeral that I had to conduct recently, and some of our staff went to. There was a boy who went up to the mother of the deceased. Now, the person who died is 15 years old. And there was a boy, a young boy, that went to the funeral during the daytime. And due to the funeral, the boy went to the mother and said he is interested to find out more about God, even though he comes from a Buddhist family. So the mom got the contact and gave it to Pastor Pauline. Pastor Pauline then forwarded the number to Pastor Titus. And this is what Pastor Titus said. When I first contacted him a week after the funeral, asking him if he would like to find out more about God, he was so eager that he wanted to meet that night itself. But however, I couldn't make it, but managed to meet him on a Tuesday with another youth leader. He was very open to sharing and eager to visit youth service. He even thanked us for contacting him, saying, "Thank you for getting in touch with me. I was starting to think that the mom lied to me about passing my contact to someone who would talk to me." Remember, don't procrastinate. So he managed to visit youth service on one Saturday and had to leave early. Another Saturday he came, and that evening he came to visit and was hosted by another youth leader. And praise be to God, he made the decision to accept Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. And Pastor Titus said this, when I asked him why he made that decision, he said he found this place to be a place where he could be accepted for his mistakes and wanted to be here to grow, to become a better person. He found this place, this church, Church of Our Savior, to be a place where he can find true peace from past hurts, true forgiveness from past mistakes, and true life for what God has prepared for him in the future ahead. Isn't it amazing that God is sending the harvest? It's reminding us things are happening. Another story was when I went to Avoda Fellowship. I met this guy. He came yesterday. His name was KK. He's KK. And he told me that he was actually seeking out, you know, enlightenment. He went to Thailand, went to different places, was a monk for a while. I talked to him because he was still wearing Buddhist clothing. So I wanted to share the gospel with him, not knowing that when he was sharing his testimony, he said that he wanted to kill himself because he was in depression. So he went to look for drugs that was banned in Singapore, searched the website, and while he was searching, a thought came to his mind. Have you tried Christianity? And so there was just a thought. He started Googling. You know what came up? Church of Our Savior. Isn't it amazing? And so he came to our church, our healing room. Then later on went to Alpha Course and went to all these classes. And he said, "Pastor, I'm going to get baptized this year." Praise the Lord, come on. And my reply to him was that, "I'm going to give you a new t-shirt." Because he was still wearing the Buddhist society thing. You will be changed. And you will be surprised at the amount of things God is doing. God is doing at the background. Remember the song that we sing, Waymaker, Miracle Worker. That was the bridge that says, even when you don't feel it, God is still working. Even when you don't see it, God is still working. So remember, when you are sowing, don't give up. Because in 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 2, in a favorable time, I listened to you. And in a day of salvation, I have helped you. Behold, now is the favorable time. Behold, today is the day of salvation. Today is the day where God is going to do something wonderful in your life. Today, for those of you who are online watching and you have never found Jesus in your life, today you can come before God and receive Him and receive eternal salvation and hope and peace for your family. Today, if there are people who are out here and you are struggling, today you can make a decision and ask God to help you. So with every eye closed, every head bowed, I want to make an invitation for maybe someone here. Maybe you have come to church for a while, you have never really committed your life to become a disciple of Jesus Christ. Today is the day. And if that's you, at the count of three, I want you to raise your hand. If you are online, I want you to later on pray a simple prayer with me. One, two, three. Anybody? Today, you want to make a commitment to Jesus Christ. Anybody? Maybe you're online. If that's you, I want you to make a very simple prayer right now. And if you're sincere about it, God hears your cry. So you pray in your heart like this: Dear Jesus, thank you for bringing me here, allowing me to listen to this message. I confess my sin before you and recognize I'm a sinner in need of your grace. I open my heart to you and invite you to come into my life and be my Lord and Savior. Today, I surrender my heart to you. Make me a Christian today, in Jesus' name. Amen. If that's you, online, or maybe some of you who are backslided and you make that prayer, remember this day, because this day, God's Spirit enter into your heart and transform from a heart of stone into a heart of flesh. And so, even as we close today, I want us also to respond to the call to sow into the kingdom. You see, God's word is powerful, but we need to act upon it. And there was a very great story about this guy called Zinzendorf. When he was young, he went to a university and went to the art museum and he saw a painting of Jesus Christ. And the painting of Jesus Christ, the title is Behold a Man. And Zinzendorf knelt down before the painting because he saw right before him Jesus Christ was crowned with the crown of thorns with blood flowing down. And right beneath the painting, there was this word: All this I've done for you. What have you done for me? It was as though Jesus himself was telling Zinzendorf, I've given my life to you. All this I've done for you. I've loved you so much. How are you going to love me back? And Zinzendorf caught on, committed his life to a lifetime of service and ministry. And after him came missionaries, a movement that produced missionaries. And so today I want you to respond also, to respond to the word of God, not just being inspired. But if you make a commitment to do something today, I want you to think about it right now. Maybe to visit someone today. Maybe to show kindness to someone today. Maybe to forgive someone today. Maybe to release forgiveness. If you have already decided what you're going to do today, right? Once you are decided, think about it. I give you some moment. Think about it. You have decided. I want you to stand up. I'm going to pray for you. All right? Once you're ready. If you are not standing, I'm not releasing you. No, just kidding. If you're not standing means you're not thinking hard enough. There's something you need to do today. Okay, think about it. But don't rush it. It's a very sacred moment. I know God is here and He's speaking to all of us. Okay, once you're ready, you can stand up. I already know what I want to do today for the kingdom of God. If you know that, stand up and then we'll close. Thank you. Thank you. for those of you who have stand. I know it's not easy. Maybe the things that you want to do is difficult, but God is going to give you strength to do it. Thank you. Father, we want to thank you for those who have responded, those who have said yes, and also said, I'm going to do it today. Help us, Lord, give us strength. Strength to overcome the things that we could not. Strength to also sow into your kingdom. Help us, Lord, because we know that you love us. And we want to offer our life to you. We want to give you our very best, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Shall we all stand now to use this song as a response song to God?
My acclaim, the joy and the pain, I'm making them yours. Lord, I offer my life to you, everything I've been through, use it for your glory. Sacrifice, Lord, I offer you my life.
Things in the past,
and things in the past,
all things yet
unseen, wishes and dreams that are yet to come through.
Raise our hands and receive the benediction. And so, Lord, now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God our Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, with our family, with our loved ones, now and forever. Amen. Amen. Praise God.